Okay, so it doesn't work for older Model S and Model X cars.
All right, guys, welcome back to the channel. Hope you're having a great day. We've got the latest update, 2020-32.3. There have been a couple of different releases, 32-dot releases coming out in the last few weeks, 32.1, 32.2, but this is the latest and greatest, 32.3. Brings a whole host of improvements. I'll touch upon them one by one. I'll talk about the ones that we got. I also will talk about the ones that we did not get for other people that it may be applicable to based on their car and their vehicle configuration. So stay tuned. All right, so we're talking about the latest update, 2020-32.3. Let's jump right into the release notes. First and foremost, it says Sirius XM improvements. That means the Sirius XM menu has been revamped. The UI has been revamped. We kind of talked about this one in the last update, but this is just a further reiteration of that with additional refinements and improvements to make the experience for people who use Sirius XM that much better. The next update is Tesla Powerwall coordination. For those that have Tesla Powerwalls, it says your car coordinates with the Powerwall for enhanced charging during a power outage without exceeding energy and power capabilities of your Powerwall system. Powerwall continuously responds to changing power needs of your home and will slow down or stop your car's charging, keeping your home loads powered. Okay, so what that means is if you have a Powerwall, you may or may not have your 24-volt outlet or your Tesla wall connector backed up to your Powerwall. You may or may not have that. If you do have it backed up, what typically would happen would be that if you charge your car, if you have your car set to charge on a timer, what winds up happening is that your car could basically drain the entirety of the Powerwall battery, leaving nothing for your home to be backed up. Okay, so this improvement looks to fix that and allows you to charge and stop charging based on the needs of your overall home, giving your home backup needs the priority for the Powerwall or Powerwalls that you may have. Okay, this doesn't apply if you don't have that outlet, that car charging outlet, not backed up. Some people choose not to do that because things like HVAC and the car charger itself drain a lot of the battery, and they want to use that for more of the regular outlets, you know, refrigerators, things like that, lights and things like that. People choose to have that backed up. So this is really going to be dependent on how you have your setup for your power walls and your solar, etc. But again, if you do have your charging infrastructure at your house backed up to your power wall, this is going to regulate that and allow for a priority for the home over priority of charging your car. The next update is a pretty big update because people have been asking for this one for a while. And this is just left open notifications. When you leave your car door, your frunk or your trunk open, or even your windows, the car should be able to notify you, right? And send you an alert to let you know that you left them open. Okay, so this is a pretty cool feature, long overdue. People have been asking about this for years prior to the Model 3 and Model Y, but this is great. So mobile notification will be sent if the trunk, frunk, or any door is left open over 10 minutes. If all doors and trunks are locked, a notification will be sent if any window or sunroof is detected to be open for 10 minutes. So if your car is locked, windows and sunroof are open, you'll send a notification. If your car is unlocked and any of the doors, trunks or frunks are open, that's also gonna send a notification. So good job for Tesla for that. Other than that, we're talking about suspension improvements. Again, this is what we got. We're gonna talk about other things that other people have gotten. So suspension improvements. And they're saying, hey, they've simplified the Tesla suspension control logic to better support both temporary and permanent heights. If a ride height is manually adjusted to high or very high, your car now will automatically lower itself after a short drive. For snowy and off-road conditions, tap keep next to the interface to keep that ride height so it doesn't automatically lower, basically, is what it's saying. Okay, for steep driveways and places where you have the auto raise, that's going to be consistent. All right, so this is a good improvement. And basically what they've done is they've adjusted the UI. So going to the UI, I look at it, now it's different. It's totally different. It used to be these wide buttons that were up here going up and down. You would select low, standard, high, very high. This is more informative, more elegant, more aligned with the times where we have low, standard, high, very high. Okay, so it shows the actual distance from the ground from the, in terms of clearance that it's going to give you. All right, and again, if you raise it to standard, right? If you raise it to high, right? Now when you go to high or very high, it's going to say always auto raise at this location or keep until 35 miles an hour. So again, trying to maintain the suspension system over time and to make sure it doesn't break or damage anything, it's allowing you to only keep this height, high or very high, up until 35 miles an hour. It will automatically drop down to standard. Now, if I don't press keep and I just drive, as soon as I drive, most likely over 35 miles an hour, it'll automatically drop down by itself. Okay, so just different ways to be able to maintain and keep this suspension working as it should over time and not breaking, not having faults because you're riding with it too high for too long, not causing any other issues in terms of imbalance with the car by having it high or very high for too long. So this is really good, especially for cars like the Model X, where having the suspension high puts a lot of stress on different parts of the car. Okay, so keeping it at standard or low is ideal. I ride the Model S, so we keep it at low all the time. It's better for handling. It's better for acceleration. And then it automatically raises once you put it in the park. So good here. Now, this is what we got. Just to divert really quickly, if you have a Raven Model S or X, and that means you have the adaptive dampening feature to that, which is the new suspension setup, you have additional features. Now, this is just the basic setup. What you have for the new one, basically, it'll give you the readout for adaptive dampening, allow you to be able to adjust that as well. You'll see the slider down here. But then also it gives you a new visualization. It actually visualizes what the adaptive dampening is doing while you're driving, which is very, very awesome. Very, very cool. Gives you lots of readouts, lots of gauges, as you can see here, as to what's going on in the car in terms of handling, in terms of all the technical bits of dampening and suspension while you're driving. So very cool. I don't think it's very practical. I don't think we're going to sit and ride with the suspension monitor up all the time. But if you're in an engaged situation, maybe you're on a track, maybe you're doing something kind of cool, you could have this up to get a good sense of, you know, where you want to adjust the suspension to get a better time or do whatever the case may be. So this is really good. Or just to understand what setting is best for you and what the impact of that setting is going to be on the car based on the visualization. Similar to how track mode unlocks lots of statistics about the car, as well as Ludicrous Plus unlocks additional statistics about the car in terms of power output from the different motors. So all good information, all good stuff from Tesla. Happy to see it. You'll also notice that in this interface and this visualization here, we also no longer have jack mode. Jack mode has been moved to service. And now you have the jack mode in here, right? So jack mode is right here, along with other things like camera calibration. These are sort of unnoted, documented features that are in these different releases. Being able to clear autopilot calibration, sort of restart the calibration for that as well. And then your wheel configuration is also here to be able to set the type of wheels that you have, okay? So a lot of the service items are finding themselves in here, which makes a lot of sense. However, I did enjoy having jack mode in suspension just because a lot of the texts that would go to fixed tires or that are non-Tesla texts are pretty familiar as to where it was. And it kind of makes sense that it's in the tire suspension setting area of the car. But either way, no problem, no big deal. Last but not least, you also have the notification history here, which is going to show you notifications. All right. So notifications that have happened in the car, you want to have a log to be able to see that. Right. So it says easily review current and past notifications by tapping controls, service, notifications. Okay. So notifications, again, this is a log. I have a notification handy right here. This is for my USB drive, which apparently is too slow for Tesla Cam. So it'll show here and it gives you a long log of current notifications, which are the ones that are highlighting right here, where some USB clips are not saved because the USB dash cam is too slow. I have a newer one, but I haven't put it in yet, so I'm just using the older one. It has a better form factor for me. It's more flush to the console than the new one, so I like it. And then here are the additional past notifications for when the vehicle brake hold was engaged, things like that. So these are things that typically the service center would have to see by logging into the secret menu or logging into service mode. But this is just surfacing, again, a lot of that information, a lot of that data to the end user. So you can take a look and see what's going on with your car and what has been going on with your car. All right. So that's cool. All good there. Let's talk about some of the things that we did not get in this release. So one of the things that we did not get in the release, as we jump over to our good folks at Tesla Scope, is the dynamic brake lights. Okay, so if you're driving over 31 miles an hour, brake forcefully, the lights will start to flash more quickly to warn other drivers that your car is rapidly slowing down. If your car comes to a complete stop, the hazards will come on and will flash until you press the accelerator or manually press the hazard warning light button to turn it off. So that's a good safety feature. This was previously on the Model 3, so it's not really big news. It's just being released to more cars now, specifically the Model Y, the Model S and X, the newer versions. It does not seem to be the older versions of Model S and Model X, just based off the release notes, but we'll try it out and see if that's the case. Okay, so doesn't work for older Model S and Model X cars, just for the newer ones with that dynamic brake light feature, and then Model 3 and Model Y as well. So next thing, this is the other one we talk about for the additional updates, is the closed windows on lock. This is a feature exclusive to Model Y and Model 3, which basically says that you can now automatically roll up your windows when it is locked to enable this setting. Controls, locks, closed windows on lock, which means that if you leave your windows down when you leave and walk away from your car, you lock it, the windows will automatically go up. So this is something a little bit different, not available for Model S and Model X, unfortunately. It's sad that the more premium vehicles don't get these types of features, but hey, it is what it is. So that's where these notifications may not be as applicable, because the windows will automatically go up if you have the setting turned on. If you haven't turned off, you'll have the backup of the notifications, which will alert you that windows are down. All right, supercharger improvements. So now you're able to charge at V3 superchargers at up to 250 kilowatt hours peak rates. As usual, when navigating to a supercharger, the battery will precondition itself to make you be able to charge as fast as possible. So that's pretty cool. So supercharger V3 in this specifically is for, if I can press it, Model S and Model X vehicles, most likely the newer ones with the newer technology. Okay, so Raven Model S and X cars specifically. All right, in addition to that, we talked about the suspension improvements. We sort of talked about that already. We're not gonna get too much into that. But the adaptive dampening ones is pretty cool. So adaptive dampening suspension now has an advanced setting that allows you to customize the level of ride comfort and handling in addition to existing comfort, auto, and sport. So this is, again, tying into that visualization. The visualization and readout is one part of it. The other part of it for the suspension is that you are able to customize it to adjust it to exactly the way you want it to be. All right, and then third-party charging stations. So now when you have a third-party charging station here, when you go to a third-party charger, what typically happens is you put your adapter on the third-party charger to be able to charge your Tesla. And then what happens is, because that charger is not a Tesla charger, it doesn't have the frequency inside the actual connector, so that when you press it, it automatically unlocks the charge port. So what this does is it says that, hey, when you're at a third-party charging station, probably geo maps the location. When you unlock your car, the charge port will automatically unlock as well, allowing you to quickly get that connector out of your car without having to then go and open the latch manually through the control panel or through your phone. So that's pretty cool. Okay, that's pretty much it for what we got. That's pretty much it for this update. Pretty big update. Pretty big updates coming soon as well with new visualizations. We'll talk about that once it comes out. But otherwise, let me know your thoughts on this update. Let me know if you saw anything different, if you've noticed any updates, any changes to the UI that weren't there before in this particular update. Let me know if you like this update, if you don't like this update. Let's leave it in the comments. Let's talk about it. Until the next time, enjoy your day. Enjoy your Tesla.